the last class we have seen about allocation methods. In the allocation methods, we have something called as a continuous allocation method. Continuous means if I have a free space of memory continuously, then only I will allocate the any process or any memory or any storage. If I want any movie to be stored and it requires some one, let us say suppose some 150 MGA memory free space is required to store one movie. So in that case, if 150 is not there, is continuously it is not there, then we have to say continuous allocation is not possible. If 150 is available in the continuously, then we can say continuous allocation. In continuous allocation, files are assigned to continuous areas of secondary storage. Then user space. User space in continuous allocation, files are assigned to continuous area of secondary storage. So in continuous allocation, the memory should be free for continuously. So then only we'll allocate the any data or any program or anything which is required to store in memory, then only it will be allocated. That's what your continuous allocation. So then we have seen advantages and disadvantages of a continuous memory allocation. Then linked allocation. Linked means in continuous allocation, what is the disadvantage? If memory is free in a distributed place, some memory is free in the first row, some more memory is free in the second row, some more memory is free in the third row, some more memory is free in the fourth row. Then what you have, what you can do in continuous allocation, we cannot allocate because memory free space is not continuous. So in that case, we can look into a linked allocation. Linked allocation means here from if the free memory is fine in the first, in the second, in the third, in the fourth. So then you can link all these. So that's what is called as a linked allocation. So linked allocation solves all problems of continuous allocation. With linked allocation, each file is a linked list of disk blocks. The disk blocks may be scattered anywhere on the disk. The directory contains a pointer to the first and the last blocks of the files as shown in this part. That's what a linked allocation. An index allocation. So what we do, we keep one memory only for index. This index is same like your textbook. In your textbooks, what we are doing, we have an index page. So what we have in index page, so we try to keep the index. So first chapter, this particular heading is here. Second chapter, this particular heading is here. So like this, we have something called as an indexed allocation. So allocate the indexed file so that it can be allocated. That's what an index. You keep one memory and keep the index allocation of a disk space. Then the free space management. Wherever the free space is there, how do I manage? And we have seen one was bit vector. So what we do in bit vector is, so suppose you have a continuous seat. And how will you go and sit there? If the seat is not sat by any person or anyone, then you go and sit. So then what we, by seeing, by our eyes, we can do that. But in the system, how we have to do? So in that case, we have something called as a bit vector. So in the bit vector, what we are doing, we are saying either 0 or 1. So in that case, so if 0 is there, means the memory is full. If 1 is there, means the memory is free where you can allocate. So that's the reason you can see here, 0, 0, 1. So in the second place, memory is free. Third place, memory is free. Fourth place, memory is free. Place memory is free. So like this, we have memory frees 2, 3, 4, 5, then 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So like this, memory is free. That's what here we can do with the bit vector. So linked list. So what we do in a linked list? So in data structures, what you have studied, we have a different nodes. One node, second node, third node, third. So like this, we have so many nodes. So link all these nodes. That's what a linked list is. So you have to think about the linked list. Then grouping. So now what we are doing, so in your labs also what we have done, because 60 students at one stretch, we cannot teach all 60 students. then what we are doing, grouping. We try to group 30 students in one batch, another 30 students in another batch. So what we have done, grouping has been done. Again, in that 30 students, two or three stats will be there. Each one will be allocated with 10, 10 or 15. What we are doing, grouping. Same way how you have done in your mini project, each group is having a particular group. So that's what a group is. Counting, so we keep, another approach is to keep the address of the first free block and number n of free continuous blocks that allow the first one. That's what a counting is. Next, we move on to disk structure. So how should be the structure? So now we may have, suppose if you consider your dining table, what we have seen in the dining pool problem. How was the dining table? It was in a circle. So always the dining table is not required to be in a circle. It can be in square, it can be in a rectangle. The same way here, how should be my disk? So whether I have to divide my disk into sectors or how? That's what here, disk provide the bulk of secondary storage for modern computer system. The magnetic tape was used as an early secondary storage medium, but the access time is much lower than for the disk. The modern disk drives are addressed as large one-dimensional array of logical blocks, where the logical block is the smallest unit of transfer. The size of the logical block is usually 512 bytes, although some disks can be low-level formatted to choose a different logical block size, such as 1024. That's what here we see about the logical blocks. So how is this logical block? Modern disk drives are addressed as a large one-dimensional array of logical blocks, where the logical block is the smallest unit of transfer. The size of the logical block is usually 512 bytes, although some disks can be low-level formatted to choose a different logical block size, such as 1024. So the one-dimensional array of logical blocks is mapped onto secondary of the disk sequentially. Sector 0 is the first sector of the first rack on the outermost cylinder. So how this is done? So that's what, if you have a round thing, so we this is sequentially divided or broken into sectors, and each sector is numbered. So sector 0 is the first sector of the track, first track of the outermost cylinder. The mapping proceeds in order through that track, then through the rest of the track is that cylinder, and then through the rest of the cylinders from the outermost of the innermost. So what we do, how it has been done? So we start from our outermost, then go for the next innermost, next innermost, next innermost. So that's what your disk structure is. The next one, disk scheduling. So one of the responsibility of operating system is to use hardware efficiently. So that's what here we have how many systems in our lab? There are so many huge systems. So that should be utilized for all the semesters of MCA. First semester, second semester, third semester, and fifth semester. Equally, it should be, disk should be taken. So this will help in achieving fast access time and disk bandwidth. The access time has two major components: the seek time, the rotational latency, the disk bandwidth. Seek time is the time for the disk arm to move the head to the cylinder containing the desired sector. Then the rotational latency is the additional time waiting for the disk to rotate the desired sector to the disk arm or disk head. So then disk bandwidth is the total number of bytes transferred divided by the total time between the first request for servicing and completion of the last transfer. We can improve both the access time and the bandwidth by scheduling the servicing of disk input output request in a good order. So what we are doing here in a disk scheduling. So if we take one more example, so now you are attending the classes from 8:30 So today is Saturday. Till 12:50, you have a classes. So what is there? How it is been done? There is a timetable. What is that timetable? It is a schedule. First hour, this lecturer has to take this subject. Should go. Second hour, this subject. Third hour, this subject. Fourth hour, this subject. So that's what is called as a disk scheduling. One of the responsibility of the operating system is to use the hardware efficiently. This will help in achieving fast access time and disk bandwidth. The access time has two major components: the seek time, the rotational latency, the bandwidth. Seek time and the rotational latency. Seek time is the time for the disk arm to move the head to the cylinder containing the desired sector. The rotational latency is the additional time waiting for the disk to rotate the desired sector to the disk head. The bandwidth, this bandwidth is the total number of bytes transferred divided by the total time of the first request for the servers and the completion of the last transfer. So we can improve both the access time and the bandwidth by scheduling the servicing of a disk input-output request in a good order. So that's what here. So you can see the bandwidth. So now you people have to attend the classes from 8:30 to every day till 4:30. So then, because it is online, you should know what data pack you require for attending all the classes. Same way here, bandwidth. So I have to transfer the amount of data and how I am totally dividing it. That's what a disk bandwidth. Whenever a process needs input output to or from the disk, it issues a system call to the operating system. The request specifies several pieces of information, whether this operation is input or output, what the disk address for transfer is, what the memory address for the transfer is, what the number of bytes to be transferred is. That's what here, this is what we have to see with respect to a disk. It is desired the disk drive and controller are available. The request can be served immediately. If the driver or controller is busy, a new request for service will be placed on the queue of the pending request for that drive. For a multi-programming system with many processes, the disk queue may often have several pending requests. Thus, when one request is completed, the operating system chooses which pending request to serve the next. Next, we see first one, first come, first serve. So that's what, suppose you think that you are standing in a queue and you have to take, you are in a temple queue. So then what will be the process? First person who is standing in the first place will be the first person to take a darshan. That is what here first come, first serve scheduling. The simplest form of disk scheduling is, of course, the first come, first serve algorithm. This algorithm is intrinsically fair, but it generally does not provide the fastest service. Example, consider a disk queue with the request for input output to block on. The cylinders 98, 183, 37, 122, 14, 124, 65, 67. All these are the disk present in the queue. In which order I have to execute, and there are how many cylinders? 200 cylinder numbered from 0 to 199. So how many cylinders we have? We have 200 cylinders. And what is the number given to all these cylinders? 0, 1, 2, 3, like this till 99. The disk head is initially at the cylinder 53. So total compute total head movement. So how do we do solutions? Start with cylinder 53. It will first move from 53 to 98, then to 183, 37, 122, 14, 124, 65, and finally to 67 as shown. We'll see how we have done. So now suppose what was the first cylinder we have to visit? We have to visit from 53. It is continuously till 58, you have to keep going. So how many are there? How many we have to count from 53? 53 is 1, 54 is 2nd. Like this, we have to count till 48, 98. So total how many will be there? It will be 45. Similarly, after 98 to 83. So why we have done like this? So because we have been told that it is first come, first serve. And what are the blocks? How many blocks for one particular disk we have? It is divided into sectors. First complete outer sector, then go for the inner sector, then you go for the next sector. So that's what you keep going. And so what is the total head movements we go? 640. So this you would have at least seen in the olden days, we were having, at least you would have seen in your movies, what we have here is, so we have something called CD was there, very big CD, golden color one. And if you keep that on that, that particular song, you were able to listen. Same way here, this is what the disk scheduling is also like that only. Where the memory, where I have to point the pointer, next where. So like this, I have to go for first come, first serve scheduling. So this is a diagram where you can see we started from 53 till 98, it is continuous. From 98 to 183 is next one. So 183 to 37 is next. From 37 to 124 is next one. Then 124 to 14 is next. 14 to 124 is next. 124 to 63 is next. Like this, we have to do first come, first serve scheduling. Then is shortest seek time first. So what we have to do for shortest seek time? So algorithm selects the request with the minimum seek time for the current head position. Since seek time increases with the number of cylinders traversed by the head, SSTF chooses the pending request to the current head position. Consider the disk queue with request for input output to blocks on cylinders 98, 183, like this we have to do. So what is the shortest seeking time first? That's what we have seen, shortest job first in the CPU scheduling. Whichever was having the short job, that was given first for the CPU execution. Same way here also. So here what we are doing is shortest seek time. So whichever is taking a small time to seek, so that will be the first one will be allocated. That's what here SSTF means what? Shortest seek time first. Algorithm selects the request with a minimum seek time from the current head position. Suppose I am here. To whom I'll reach fast? Whether I'll reach fast for Anu, or whether I'll reach fast for Chaitra, or whether I'll reach fast for Mithili, to whom will I reach first? Or Pavisha? Yes. So like this, to whom I will reach first? That's what here. Seek time. Seek time means to whom I will reach fast. So since seek time increases with the number of cylinders traversed by the head, so SSTF chooses the pending request close to the current head position. So that's what your shortest seek time. So consider a disk queue with request from input output. In that order, there are 200 cylinders numbered from same way how we have done. So we have 200 cylinders numbered from 0 to 199. The disk head is initially at the cylinder 53. Compute the, so where is the first initial head in initial disk head in the cylinder 53. Compute total head movements, how to move the head. So that's what here you can see. The closest to request to the initial head position is 53. So which one is close for 53? 65. So from 53 to 65, how much is the number of blocks taken, that is 12. So like this, we have to calculate till the end. So once we are at the cylinder 65, from 65, which is the closest? Closest is 67. So that's what. Now I have reached home for Anu. From Anu, who is close to Anu's house? Maybe Bhavishya. Where is Bhavishya's home? And who is close to Bhavishya's home? Maybe Chaitra. So if I reach Chaitra's home, and who is near Mithili? So like this, I may reach each one of you based on shortest job seeking. What we are doing in a shortest job seeking? Very soon, whom I can reach. So that's what here, that's what I'm calculating all this. You can see 12, 2, 30, 23, 84, 24, 2, 59, 9. 236. So this is what is called as the shortest seeking time first. So that's what your shortest SSTF, shortest seek time first. So then SSTF from 53, if you go to 65, from 65 who is near, 67 is near. From 65 to 37, I have to complete. After 37, who is near? 14 is near. So after 14, from 14, 98, I have to complete. So after 98, who is near to me? 122. So after 122, who is near? 124. Like this, I keep executing my other things. That's what is called as a SSTF. Seek time will be shorter. So that was the second one. And the next one is scan schedule. So now I think every one of you, at least by now, will be knowing all these years you were submitting a hard copy assignments. But now what we have told you, sitting at home only because of this corona, COVID-19. So what we are doing, we are trying to write, do your work at home place, and you are sending us. How we are sending? You are scanning the written material of your assignments and sending to us. Same way here, what we are doing, scan schedule. So there is one more algorithm called in the scan algorithm. So the disk arm starts at one end of the disk and moves towards the other end. Servicing request as it reaches each cylinder. Until it gets to another end of the disk, at the other end, the direction of the head movement is reserved. And servicing continues. The head count, head continuously scans back and forth across the disk. Consider the disk queue. How is the disk? So how is first is 98, next is 183, 37, 122, 14. Like this, we have a blocks of cylinders. So in this order, so in the scan algorithm, what we do, the disk arm starts at one end of the disk and moves towards the other end. Serving request on it reaches each cylinder until it goes to the other end of the disk. At the other end, the direction of the head movement is reserved and serving continues. The head continues scan back and forth across the disk. So how you are scanning? You keep your sheet here and you click first page. Then you click on the second page. Why you are doing? Because you should know which is the first page of your assignment, which is the second page, which is the third page. You start scanning all this. Same way here. Scanning scheduling. So what it do, it start from the start disk, then go to the second, next go to the second. This is what the scan scheduling is. So before applying scan algorithm, we need to know the current direction of the head movement. Assume that disk arm is moving towards 0 and the head will serve 37 and then 14. So like this, we have to do it for a scan algorithm. So at cylinder 0, the arm will reserve and will move towards the other end of the disk, serving the request. It will start from 65, 67, then move on to the 98, then 122, then 124, then 128, 128, 183. So like this, the disk header will keep moving. So we'll see the next slide how this is moved. A head movement from 53 to 37. Then how many blocks are there in that? 16. So then 37 to 14, how many blocks are there? 23. Then 14 to 0 is 0. Then coming back, 0 to 65 is 65. 65 to 67 is 2 blocks. 67 to 98, again 31 blocks. 98 to 122, 24 blocks. Then 122, 124, 2 blocks. 124 to 183, 59. Then the total movement is 236. So scan disk scheduling, it starts from 53, moves to 37, from 37 to 14, from 14 to 0, then 0 to 65, 65 to 67, 65 to 98, 98 to 122, 122 to 124, 124 to 183. Like this, we keep doing with the scan disk algorithm, where start from one particular, go till that particular end and see where is the near one, then go. So like this, we keep going the scan disk schedule. Then we have something called as a circular scan. In the same way, even you, when you're taking your assignment photos, there are different ways. One, you would have opened your camera and taken. And one more option, you at least right now, everyone are using the scanners. So again, in that scanner, there are different types of scanners. How do we do? Same. Even, but what at the end of the day, what we want everything in the form of output. That's what here, C scan scheduling. C means what? Circular. So circular scan scheduling is the variant of scan designed to provide a more uniform wait time. So like scan, C-scan moves the head from one end of the disk to the other, serving request along the way. So what it is then? Circular. So you would have seen your data structure circular queue. So what it is doing? The first head of the node is linked to the last head of the node. Then you, this is what is called as a circular queue. Same way here, circular scan. So what it is doing? Scheduling is variant of scan designed to provide a more uniform waiting time. So here what we have done, waiting time is made it as a more uniform. Like scan, C-scan moves the head from one disk, from one end of the disk to the other, serving request along the way. When the head reaches the other end, however, it immediately returns to the beginning of the disk. So once it is done, it moves on to the beginning without serving any request on the return trip. So that's what here figure. We'll see how we have done. The C-scan scheduling algorithm essentially treats the cylinders as the circular list that wraps around from the final cylinder to the first. So example for this is, consider a disk queue with request for input output to the block. So on this cylinder, this is what 98, 183, 37, 122, 14, 124, 65, 70. So like this, it keeps going on. That's what is called as a C-scan. The C-scan scheduling, in that order, there are 200 cylinders numbered from 0 to 199. So the disk head is initially at the cylinder 53. Compute total head movement. So what we are doing, so before applying C-scan algorithm, we need to know the current direction of the head movement. So whether the direction, so at least you'll be knowing whether east, west, north, south, like this we have direction. The same way in head movement, so whether it is moving on a clockwise or anti-clockwise, how it is moving, that's what your direction of the head movement is required. Assume that the disk arm is moving towards 99. Suppose you think that, so it is moving, how it is moving, wherever there is 99, it is moving towards 99. The head will serve 65, 67, 98, 122, 124, then 183. Then it will move on to the 99. So what it will do? So whichever are there. So it wants to go to 99. Before that, whichever comes on the way, it will be serving all this. So before 99, what are the other blocks we are getting? We are getting 65, 67, 98, 122, 124, and 183. So how this is serving? So this is how it is serving. Then it will move to a 99 and the arm will reserve and move towards 0. While moving towards 0, it will not serve. But after reaching 0, it will serve, it will reverse again and then serve 49, 37. So it is shown in figure 84. So how we are doing? Head movement from 53 to 65, 12, 55 to 67, 67 to 98. 98 to 122, 122 to 124, 124 to 83, 83 to 89. Like this, it keeps going. But you can see why the blue color one is, because the head want to reach to 199. When before if you want to reach 99, you have to traverse all this. So that's the reason. So that's the reason 199. So this is what is called as a scanner. You can see here. So because of this, it has to move to 99. From 99, where it has to go, it has to start from 53, 65, 67, 98, 122. Like this, we should keep going. That is what is called as a 99 or a C-scan disk. This one is a loop scheduling. As we described them, both scan and C-scan move the disk arm across the full width of the disk. In practice, Neither algorithm is implemented this way. More commonly, the arm goes only as far as the final request in each direction. Then it is reserves direction immediately without going all the way to the end of the disk. These versions of scan and gscan are called look and see look scheduling because they look for a request before continuing to move in a given direction. That's what you are looking. So can we walk without eyes? No. Then something we want. So what we want, we have to look. Because if something is, when I am keeping step, I should know there is no hole inside, so that if I keep step, I will go down. So that's what here look. So what is this look scheduling is doing? As we described in C and C scan, what we have done in C and scan and C scan, wherever the disk arm is there, which is nearest, then we keep going. So in practice, neither algorithm is implemented in this way. More commonly, the arm goes only as far as the final request in the direction. Then it reverse direction immediately without going all the way to the end of the disk. So these version of scan and C scan are called loop. So what they have done in a loop is they have combined the properties of scan and C scan and made it as a look and a see look because they look after a request before continuing to move in the given direction. So consider a disk queue with the request for input output to blocks on cylinders. So 98, 183, 37, 122, 14, 124, 65, 67. In that order, there are 200 cylinders numbered from 0 to 199. The disk head is initially at the cylinder 53. Compute total head movement. So here, assume that disk arms is moving towards 199. The head will serve 65, 67, 98, 122, 124, and 183. Then the arm will reverse and move towards 14. Then it will serve 37. So this is how the head movement will be done. That's what you can see. First, it will start from 53 because the head movement is at the position 53. It starts from 53, move to 65. From 65, it moves on to 67. From 67, it moves on to 98. From 98, it moves on to the 122. So that 122, it goes on 124. Then 124, it goes on 83. Then 83 to, it will come to 0, 14. Then 14, it will come to the reverse direction from 14, it will go to 37. So this is what is called as a loop disk scheduling. Next, we move on to a disk management. So now, who is managing all this? So the head of the institute or principal is managing whole college. Same way here. So how should I manage the disk? So sometimes you would have seen that if you keep your pen drive somewhere and if there is a virus, it will say you, your pen drive has to be formatted. Same way here also, the operating system is responsible for several other aspects of disk management as well. So disk formatting, a new magnetic disk is a blank slate. It is just pattern of magnetic recording material. Before a disk can store data, it must be divided into sectors that the disk control can read and write. This process is called a low-level formatting or physical formatting. Low-level formatting disk fills the disk with a special data structure for each sector. So how this magnetic disk? Disk is what your hard disk. So how is this? A new magnetic disk is a blank slate. It is just pattern of magnetic recording material. So how do we do it? That's what here is a magnetic. Before a disk can store data, it must be divided into sectors that the disk controller can read and write. This process is called low-level formatting or physical formatting. So low-level formatting fills the disk space with a special data structure for each sector. Next, to use a to use a disk to hold files, the OS needs to record its own data structure on the disk. It does so in two steps. One, the first step is to partition. So that's what here, if the project is very big and I will divide it into some four partition, then I'll give for each one of them. Same way here. So when you purchase your laptops also, the memory will be continuous. Then it should be partitioned. So to partition that, what you want, there is a systematic way where you can partition. The first step is to partition the disk into one or more groups of cylinders. That's what you have done in your laptops also. You have something called as a C drive, D drive, E drive, F drive. So how all these are done? So when you purchase a new laptop, there will be no such drives. So after you purchase, you start dividing or partitioning it. The first step is to partition the disk into one or more groups of cylinder. The OS treats each partition as though it were the separate disk. So one is a partition, divide the partition. After partitioning, the second step is logical formatting or creation of the file system. In this step, the OS stores the initial file system data structure on the disk. These data structure may include maps of pre and allocated space and an initial empty directory. But then boot blocks. They would have known that at least initially, how is this block or how is this boot? For a computer to start running, it needs to have an initial program to run. The bootstrap program initializes all aspects of the system, from CPU registers to device controllers and contents of main memory, and then starts the OS. To do its job, the bootstrap program finds the OS kernel on the disk and loads that kernel into memory and jumps to the initial address, begin the operating system execution. That's what here how we are doing. This is a boot block. So initially, once we purchase anything, we should boot. Same way here, what is this boot block? So the same way what we are doing in our laptops, we are partitioning our memory into different parts. So generally what we do in a C drive, we keep all our system files. Same way here, the boot blocks is what, how the job is being done or what the kernel is doing. So main thing, because if something by mistake in the kernel of the operating system, if we delete, then our operating system gets corrupted, then we cannot get back. So that's what your boot block is. The same way next is bad block. So the same way how our laptops may have a virus, if we don't have antivirus in our laptops, then definitely the virus will come and disable some of the properties which are there in the system. Same way here, so bad block. So because this having moving parts and small tolerance, they are prone to failure. So suppose you think that you open your port some 100 times each day. So then what it will do, next day it will not work. That's what, in the same way. So bad blocks is, there are tiny things. So sometimes we have to handle them very carefully. Same way here, sometimes the failure is complete. The disk needs to be replaced and its content restored from a backup media to a new disk. So now what we are doing, so earlier we were having the mobiles where it was not connected to the internet. And if I lose my mobile, all my contacts was going on. But now what we have, so we have, every one of you also have a smartphone and keep the backup in the backups in the disk or a drives, your Gmail account, wherever. So then you can get back all your contacts. Same way here, bad block is a tiny thing where we are seeing to that it should not be get deleted. So more frequently, one or more sectors becomes defective. That's what always, when you are loading any disk, so they say that don't touch the disk. So handle it very carefully, because whatever the data is there, it can be erased. So depending on the disk and the controller in use, the blocks are handled in a variety of ways. One simple disk is with the IDE. the bad blocks are handled manually. The controller maintains a list of bad blocks on the disk. The list is initialized during the low-level format of the factor and is updated over the life of the disk. That's what about the bad blocks. So now we continue this in the next class with the security problem. So before ending the class, we'll just revise what we have done today. So we have started with disk scheduling. So what is the disk scheduling? So that it is divided. Two major components are required for a disk scheduling. One is a seek time, and one more was a rotational latency. So then we have seen about a disk bandwidth. So what is the bandwidth required to load all your data? So then we have seen about some more points. What are the advantages of having the information, and what are the advantages as well as disadvantages? Next, we have seen about the first come first serve scheduling. So what is this first come first serve? Whoever comes first, that person will be served first. Same way here also, first come first serve is algorithm where whichever process comes first, that will be processed first. That is what first come first serve scheduling. And we have seen a diagram also with the diagrammatic representation where we are starting, which process, which number we have started, from there where we are ending. So like this, we have seen all from starting to the end of the processes. So whichever comes first, that will be first executed. Next, we have seen about the shortest seek time first. Same way what we have seen in CPU scheduling, whichever job is small, that will be executed first. Same way here, the shortest seek time. So what is the time taken for me to travel from here to the next stop? If it is very small, then I go to that stop. That same way here, the shortest seek time is where we concentrate, or concentration is given on the seek time, which is the shortest one. Then we have seen about the scan scheduling. Then we have followed with the pre-scan scheduling. Same way how we have a scanner, same concept is used here also. Then we have seen about the loop scheduling. Then we have also seen about the disk management. So how to manage the disk. And in that case, we have seen about the partitioning. So in the same way, when you purchase your laptop, memory will be complete. After you purchase new one, you start dividing or partitioning your memory. A, B, C drive, D drive, E drive, like that left to you how you divide. Same way here, the partitioning is also required for your memory. And we have seen about the boot blocks. So once you purchase, you can load any type of operating system, either Windows based or Linux based or Unix based. Any of these operating system, you can load it. So that's what we generally call it as a boot blocks. And we have seen about the bad blocks. Same way, how you touch the corner of your CD, maybe your data may be spoiled. So that's what touch carefully. Same way here, it's about the bad blocks. So I'll stop here and we'll continue in the next.